How's everyone doing? Good, unsure, undecided. Happy Mother's Day to the mothers in the room, to those that aim to be mothers, those that have gone before us, those that have just mothers all around. I love this day so much. Jody's the glue in our family, so I mean, without her, we'd be lost. So, what was that? She's oh, thanks. You're not wrong, but nice to see some familiar faces back with us as well. Tyler and Ayla, I'm looking at you. Nice to see you. We'll connect afterwards. Why don't you stand if you already aren't, and we're gonna join in some worship together.
Stand again. Oh, shall worship your holy
you.
in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you.
It's your breath.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that where we are, you meet us here. So God, we just thank you so much that we can meet your presence here, God, and we can come to connect with you in a deeper, more spiritual way, God. So I pray that you would just meet us here. Father, whatever we've brought with us, the burdens of the week, of the month, whatever we're carrying with us, God, I pray that we would leave it with you today. And that we would leave today changed people, God. So I pray that you would just be with Pastor Scott as he's going to come up and deliver a message soon. I pray that you would just help all of us to open our hearts to what he has to say. And I pray that you would just be with us today, God. Amen. You can grab a seat, and we're going to watch a video.
Matthew.
Next.
Besides, what else are you going to do with a mind like yours?
Matthew. Matthew, son of Alphaeus.
Yes.
Follow me.
Me?
Yes, you.
Whoa. What are you doing?
You want me to join you?
Keep moving, street preacher.
Do you have any idea what this guy's done? Do you even know him?
Yes.
Listen, I said to...
What are you doing? Where do you think you're going?
Guys, let me go.
Have you lost your mind? You have money. Quintus protects you. No Jew lives as good as you. You're gonna throw it all away.
Yes.
I don't get it.
You didn't get it when I chose you either.
But this is different. I'm not a tax collector.
Get used to different.
I'm glad we passed by your booth today, Matthew.
Yes.
Shall we? We have a celebration to prepare for.
You will regret this, Matthew.
What's the tablet for?
I grabbed it without thinking. You can put it back.
No, keep it. You may yet find use for it.
Where are we going?
A dinner party.
I'm not welcome at dinner parties.
Well, that's not going to be a problem tonight. You're the host.
Are you a Christian or are you a Christ follower? Are you a religious person or are you a disciple? You know, I've spent much of my life trying to figure out what a Christ follower is, what it means to be a disciple, and I've wrestled with this. You know, the night that I felt God calling me to be a leader in the church, a pastor. I was 15 years old, and there was I was in London, Ontario, London Gospel Temple, and it was the closing night of a retreat I'd been at, and it was one of those retreats that was just magical. They had planned a retreat to have some youth come from Western Ontario, and it turns out three times as many of us showed up as they had accommodations for. So they had to, they didn't have enough accommodations, so they had the whole church billet different people. And so I and about eight other guys went and stayed at this farmer's house in the outskirts of London. And my best friend and I, we shared a room, and we got up in the morning, and that was a huge layout of bacon and eggs, and it's just amazing. And we went in, and the sermons were electric. And the last sermon on the Saturday night, I guess it was a Thursday, Saturday, was, or a Sunday, no, it was a Sunday night, was I Want the Cross. And it was a message about giving everything to Jesus and giving your whole life to Him. And you know, what does it mean to give everything to Jesus? You know, what does it mean to give everything to Jesus? What does it mean to follow Him? You know, we talk a lot about what you give up to follow Him. And we all like to think we give everything to Jesus, you know, like, or we're learning how to, right? You know, some of us struggle with holding some dark parts of our heart or some of our attitude or some of our perceptions or even some of our beliefs back. And we're learning to give it all to Jesus. And that's why we gather each week, right? We gather in this room, this bar, this pub. Apparently in the community college, you know, it's a miracle that a church is here, and we get together each week and we challenge each other with what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ, and we learn and we grow, and that's good. That is good for us to grow. It is good that we gather. You cannot be a Christ follower by yourself. You need other Christ followers. You need to get together in this room, you know, where sometimes it's too loud, and sometimes it's too quiet, sometimes it's too bright. You need to get together with these people and figure this Jesus thing out, you know, and this is part of being a disciple of Jesus Christ. And I think we think it was easier in Jesus' day to be a disciple than it is now. I think we think that, you know, well, they had nothing to lose, so they, you know, they jumped in with this Jesus guy, you know, they followed him or they got in with him, and they didn't lose anything, but that's not true. In fact, in some ways it was riskier in that world to be a follower of Christ than it is in ours. You know, a lot of times we, you know, even the people who are worst off in our society, and they've been in the headlines a lot, you know, and we're concerned about people, right? Like, since 2016, 35,000 Canadians have died of fentanyl overdose in Canada. 35,000. You know, many of them young men, you know? And we're concerned about them, right? But at least we live in a country where there's programs. Some help, some don't help. Some make it worse, some make it better. But at least there's a perception of it. The attitude of our culture is not, well, they deserve it, let them die, right? The attitude of our culture is, let's try and help. Let's try to help people get better, right? So we've got that. In Jesus' day, you know, you could have a mark on your arm and lose every bit of community. You could, you know, break a rule you might not even be aware of, and get kicked out of your synagogue. Or you could look at a Roman soldier the wrong way and end up losing your life. It's a different world. Yet in this world, Jesus walked, challenged and invited people to become disciples. Christian is a word, is actually something people from the outside called the Christ ones, right? It doesn't make it a bad word, but like all perceptions from the outside of the church, it doesn't really grasp the significance of who Jesus wants us to be. I learned very early in the church as a pastor that there are some people who are Christ followers and some people who are just Christians. And by that, what I mean is church is something they do. You know, they do it, they value the morals, they, you know, bring their kids, they want to be considered a good person. And I knew, I was kind of 2 years in to our church, and there was a guy I was connecting with and getting to know. And for him, the most important thing that Kawartha Community Church could do was to have a men's hockey team in a Christian league. And, you know, God love them, have your Christian league, you know, all those kind of things. But I thought, there seems to me that there's more important things about being a Christ follower than having a Christian hockey team in a Christian league. Just didn't strike me as my top 10 list, right? But for him, that was extremely meaningful. So what does it mean to be a Christ follower? What does it mean to be a disciple? Well, Jesus in chapter 9 of Luke made this declaration. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit their very self? Whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and the holy angels. What does it mean to take up your cross? Well, that first night when I was called into ministry, October 9th, 1982, I was up at the front and I was praying. And I felt this overwhelming sense that God wanted me or was calling me. And I didn't feel elated. I felt a serious heaviness that came with that calling, like a cross across my shoulders. This heaviness. You know, and I think very years later, I was thinking that here I was 15 years old. You know, I was 6'1" and weighed 96 pounds. You know, it's kind of like a Q-tip. You know, gangly, awkward, social kid, you know. Mouth was 10 miles ahead of my brain. Tripped over my own feet, you know. And what does God call me? What is the symbolism that he calls me with? It's a cross. Thinking, like, that's not a great sales job. You know, and every Sunday we're getting together. And KCC, we have been on a track that is so beautiful. You know, and I talk to you, and you're a part of it. But it feels like our church is going somewhere. It's exciting. People are loving Jesus. They're learning scripture. They're praying. Our prayers are being answered. I mean, hallelujah. Our prayers are being answered. We see new families join us. You know, our music program is expanding. You know, Tyler's come, so you don't have to listen to me all the time. It's exciting to be a part of it. And what would motivate a group of people to get together to listen to things that go right against the grain of what it means to be happy in our culture? If you want to gain, give. If you want to lead, serve. If you want life, die. Take up a cross. But I don't want to get too psychological, but the actual challenge of being a Christ follower is an aspect of it that is desperately needed in order for it to work. We need a big mountainous goal. We need a standard set. Think of why people get married and what they say when they get married, their wedding vows, right? Enormous commitment to another individual. You know, and often that doe-eyed couple's in front of me. I mean, it's all hormones and, you know, all this. And you're thinking, you have no idea what you're signing up for, right? You know, you were looking at the other person and thinking, they're perfect for me. And that's part of the problem. And you make this huge commitment. And that's what it's like when I became a Christ follower, right? When I first accepted Jesus, it was wonderful. But there's something else we need. And it's such a part of humanity. Why? Because we are made in the image of God. We need a dragon to slay. We need a cause to be a part of. We need an insurmountable task that cannot be accomplished unless God himself helps us. It's the challenge of the cross. And so what I'm going to read an account today of some people who wanted to be Christ followers. But before they were, Jesus challenged them. And listen to these challenges. You might think, wow, Jesus is being real mean here. But I think what he's being is honest. And I think it's good for you and for me to have that honest challenge about what it means to be a Christ follower. So in verse 57, as they were walking along a road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. See, that's a big commitment, right? Jesus, wherever you're going, I'm in. What's his response? Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Are you sure you want to follow me? Are you sure you want the unpredictability to some night you're going to be lying down under the stars with your head on a rock? Some night you go to bed hungry? Are you sure you want to do that? He goes on. He said to another man, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Now, the guy's father had not just died. There was actually a familial commitment that you made that you were free of the commitment to family once you're the patriarch has been buried, because then you're the patriarch and you can make the decision to do what you want, right? So what the person is saying, well, you know, first let me go bury my father. That's what most people interpret it. But it's quite possible his dad just died too. What does Jesus say? Jesus said, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Let the dead bury their own dead. Forget the funeral. You got a job to do. Get out there and get busy. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. This is the one people really struggle with, because we, in the church especially, we really love family, right? Family's right at the top. But listen to Jesus' reply. No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom service in the kingdom of God. Wow. What is this? Is it hyperbole? So someone says, I'll follow. They're making a commitment. He says, hey, I got no place to lay my head. Someone says, follow me, but first let me bury my father. He said, let the dead bury the dead. Another one said, I'll follow you, but I have to go say goodbye to my family. He said, don't look back. Keep going. What does this mean? Well, first of all, I want you to know that Jesus has a heart, and he has grace. He really does. But he wants to be honest with you. He talks about counting the cost. He says, you know, before someone goes and goes to war, they count the cost. If they have more soldiers you have, they'll sit down and make a peace treaty because they recognize that they're in a no-win situation. He said, a follower of Jesus Christ looks forward, sees the cross, takes it on their shoulder and goes forward and commits that above and beyond anything else they do. Christ follower does that. Don't expect an easy ride. You know what? Being a Christ follower has brought me all kinds of rewards. It's brought me a congregation full of people that have to love me or they won't go to heaven. It's brought me place. You know, I work professionally. Gives me a job I love where, you know, can open up commentaries and take courses and read and learn. It's given me many things. Given me a beautiful wife and a successful marriage. It's given me two great kids, two wonderful daughter-in-laws, a granddaughter. These are all things that if you knew my familial history, you would know that most people didn't attain. It's a long, long history of broken marriages, you know, broken families, people not talking to each other, you know, ain't pretty. And probably some of your families are like that too. Jesus has given me so much. But he's challenged me to lose my life so I can gain it. There's been a lot of things, some of them that I thought were really important, that I have given up. And you know what the thing about giving up something that you think is really important and then, you know, going down the road, you realize it really wasn't that important. I remember, like, there's this one couple, I loved them, but they had a couple kids. And all I ever heard the father say is, oh, I don't get to do what I want to do. Oh, the kids, that's a lot of work. Kids are this, kids are that. Because, you know, I finally had to take them and I said, buddy, being a parent is not always fun. And it's a responsibility, true. But it's also a calling. Teaching your children is a calling. And we live in a world right now where children are at risk like never before. And many parents aren't taking responsibility for their children. And they're leaving them out there. You know, or they're actually leading them into the wrong path. Our children are a calling. And being a Christ follower is a calling. It is to take up a cross and go a direction. And sometimes that's not easy. Sometimes being a Christian is achingly hard because the things I want to do, the me-ness of my life, has to be set aside. And I don't like that. I like me. I like me to be happy. I like me to be comfortable. I like me to, you know, enjoy life. I like to do all these things. But here's the truth of the matter. If Western society is anything, it is an actual example of a society where we are eating, sleeping with, drugging and drinking ourselves to death. We are so overwhelmed with pleasure that we're killing ourselves by it. Crazy world we live in. Maybe this Jesus thing had something, maybe he had something going there about the idea of denying yourself, taking up your cross and following him. And it's really funny because he says, if you want to gain your life, you lose it. But if you want to, you know, if you don't, you try to gain your life or keep control of your life, you actually end up losing it in the end. It's that upside down world all the time. Don't hesitate. Don't hesitate. A lot of Christians, they do this. They're kind of growing, growing, growing. And then they hit a something that for them is a stumbling block. It might be volunteering, it might be sharing your faith, it might be tithing, it might be something like that. But you get to this point and you go, I can't go that far. I'm holding that one thing back. And then they basically percolate in church the rest of their lives. Being a Christ follower is this pushing on. It's progressive. It's not stagnant. It's like any relationship when you think about it. You know, if you had a friend and you did the same thing over and over and over and over again and never changed it, that friendship would start to die. Relationships need injection of new ideas and new things and new activities and new experiences. Why? Because we are too complex to settle for the status quo. And when your Christianity is status quo, and when you're just going because you've always gone, and you're always gonna go, and it's just, you know, something you come to do because it seems like a good idea, if it's habitual only, it starts to stagnate. You start getting the hardening of the spiritual arteries, and before you know it, you wake up and you go, why am I even doing this? When is the last time you prayed and felt like God answered you? You felt that leap in your heart, like God was listening and he was speaking to you. When is the last time that you were feeling lousy about something and you felt a check in the Holy Spirit, that there was a person right before you, beside you, that had a need? And you were so wrapped up in yourself, you didn't realize it. And then you go, okay, I got to get outside myself. And you go love that person. When's the last time you did that? When's the last time you felt the prompting of the Holy Spirit as you were experiencing something? You know, where you were going left and God goes, no, go right. I got something to show you here. When's the last time you cracked a Bible and read a verse and go, wow, this, okay, this is something for me. This is profound. A follower of Jesus Christ is consistently growing in that direction. And you don't do that by hesitating. And then don't look back. Don't look back. Sometimes looking back, you know, you have some little joys. You know, I look back on my calling and think, wow, God, thank you for calling me. You know? Do you know how many children we have in the room here? A lot of little girls and some little boys. Some of them are going to follow Jesus with all their hearts and they're going to change the world. They're going to take the message of Jesus and go share it with people that don't know him. Some of them are going to do that. And yet, we spend more time looking back than looking forward. You know, the Church of Jesus Christ can't be a good old days body of believers. This was a big, big problem in the 80s, 90s, is the number of believers that look back rather than looking forward. We need to get this back, you know? Like somehow we were going to Christianize Western society when it was, you know, bent on going another direction. You know what I love about COVID? It was this huge reset where people have gone, am I in this for Jesus or am I in this for me? And you know what? Our best days are in front of us. Your best days are in front of you. Don't allow the past to hold you back from what Jesus is bringing you in the future. For these people that are coming to Jesus, he's saying, no, don't look back. Go forward. Don't hesitate. Jump in. Why? Because that's where life is. To look back consistently will drain your energy. It will make you feel victimized. And some of us got some pretty dark stuff in our past, right? We've gone through an awful lot. Some of you have gone through divorces. Some of you have gone through divorce. Some of you have been beaten within an inch of your life. Some of you have been ripped off. Some of you have been fired. Some of you have gone through some horrible things. But that does not define you. Jesus defines you. And he's calling you right now. He says, you want to spend the rest of your life looking back, or are you going to move forward? God has big dreams for followers of Jesus Christ who put their head down, feet forward and move forward with Jesus Christ, to take up their cross daily and follow him. Why? Because it's unpredictable, it's scary, it's can be negative sometimes, and it is the best thing you'll ever do, because on the other side of that is life. As a minister, I have sat beside people who have died full of regret. And I'll tell you, there's a radical difference between sitting and talking to someone whose life has been Jesus and someone who's just lived life. It's so different. And when they pass from this world into eternity, the tangible difference, you can cut it with a knife. It really is. It's crazy. A number of years ago, I told this story before, but it bears repeating. Yeah, well, you know Tammy Scott. I don't know if she's not here today, but her husband's named Dave. We talk about Jesus a lot with Dave, and Dave's a great guy. And Dave's mom was sick in the hospital, and she was dying. She had so many things wrong with her that they couldn't determine what was going to be the thing to kill her, because she had like eight of them. But she was hanging on. And they had told them, be prepared, she's going to die 2 months earlier. And she was still hanging on. And I was talking to Tammy about this. I went in to where she was working, and I said, how's it going? She shared a little bit the struggles they were going through. Like, Dave just didn't understand it. It was just, it was really bothering him, and he was getting bitter about it. And angry. You know, why does she have to suffer like this? And I said to Tammy, I said, well, I got another hospital visit there tomorrow. Do you want me to stop by? Would Dave be comfortable? I always ask people because, you know, I want to make sure they're comfortable with it. And she said, well, I'll ask him. She said, I'm not sure whether it would help or not, you know. I said, well, I'll tell you what. I'll plan on coming up. And if there's any problem, let me know. Anyway, she texted me like, you know, half an hour later, said, I talked to Dave and he'd be thrilled if you would stop by tomorrow. So anyways, I go in and they're in the hospital room and his mom is lying in the bed and you got all the stuff hooked up and everything, and Dave is distraught and Tammy's upset and that. And I said, well, is it okay if I go pray with your mom? Sure, why not? All right. So I went and you try to do the minister thing, right? You know, you want to read some scripture, you want to pray, you know, you have to be sensitive to situations. Some people are agitated, some people like to, you hold their hands, other people don't. You know, there's a real science to it, there really is. But I went in, you know, and I opened up my Bible and I read the 23rd Psalm, because I think most people have heard the 23rd Psalm. It's very comforting, right? And then I felt that prompting in my heart. You know, when Jesus asks you to do something and you're going, is that you or is that just me eating too much pizza the night before? You know, is that you or whatever? And I thought, is what you're thinking aligned with Scripture? Is it something that Jesus would do? Is it something that would really address this issue? And it kind of passed the smell test, right? So I said to his mom, I said her name, and I said, I believe that you need to meet Jesus. So I'm going to say a prayer, and I want you to say it with me. You know, and she was, you know, like, she was semi-conscious, like she wasn't able to talk or anything. And then you'll meet Jesus, and then you'll be prepared for eternity. And so I said this prayer with her. I said, Jesus, I believe so-and-so wants to meet you. She wants to spend eternity with you. She wants to learn to love you. She needs you. Please meet her so that when she goes into eternity, she's going to spend eternity with you. Amen. And she smiled and died right away. And it was like, in the room, it was like electric. And Dave started crying. And Dave got on his phone and he was calling his relatives.
Wouldn't believe it.
I know why mom was hanging on. She needed to meet God. once she met God, she was okay. You know, and he came over and he's thanking me. He says, thank you so much for what you did. Thank you so much. I says, not me. This is God. You know, this is what he does. I'm just, you know, to this day, he's so grateful. And he's curious because he saw a miracle. When you follow Jesus, sometimes weird stuff happens. But the unpredictability about the challenge, the all or nothing, the win or go home attitude of being a follower of Jesus Christ doesn't make you a fanatic. What did Winston Churchill say? A fanatic is someone that can't change his mind and won't change his subject. In fact, the people I know that love Jesus are the most grounded, real people. But what it does do is it makes you unpredictable and dangerous. Because every circumstance you go into, you carry Jesus with you. You have that cross. And you are a living representative of sin made pure, of grace, of God's truth. And some people will drive them nuts, and others, it will be the answer to their prayers. And so today is a message about a cross. You look forward in Jesus. You look forward to the life ahead of you. Have you been looking back? Have you been waiting for something? Have you reached a kind of a rut that you just can't get out of? What is holding you back? Jesus' challenge to you is if you want life, you have to lose it for him. There is no keeping your life aside from Jesus. And what does it mean to follow him today? What is it that he's asking you to leave behind? And what is he's asking you to take up? Do you want a cross? People, crazy people, would you think would want a cross? But this is Jesus' challenge to us today. This has been one of the weirdest series I've ever been in because it's like, we finished our first two series in the year, and then Jesus said, Luke, preach from Luke. I want people to meet me. I want people to meet Jesus and see me for who I really am. And so I've been wrestling with that, and I've been getting together with our tree talk group, and we've been wrestling with what the scriptures mean and the significance of it, and wrestling with being a disciple and a Christ follower. And so I've been challenging you guys like crazy. And you might be getting a little sick of it. But I'm not saying this for my health. As I am learning to give more to Jesus, I am challenging you to give more to Jesus. As I am learning more about him, I'm challenging you to learn more about him. As I am taking up my cross, I'm asking you to take up your cross. Because I really believe this. This church is going some crazy places. And God has called us, and he has called us together. This room full of leaders, this room full of children, precious children, this room full of all ages, this community of Christ. God is going to do huge things in us. Who would have thought when we showed up in September, the 18 of us, that we would have so much more now? Let's not stop. Let's not stop here. Let's not pause here. Let's move forward with Christ. And that is all I got to say about that. So I'm going to take a couple of questions. Going to ask the worship team to come up. First of all, what I said about the sound earlier, we're really trying to get things balanced. This room is a nightmare for sound. And I know I have some of you that are going, turn it up, and I have some of you going, turn it down. And some of you I can hear, and some I can't hear, and all that. Just please be patient with us. We're really trying to figure it out. There's some aspects of this room I think we're going to have to live with. And then there's other aspects where we can do a little bit here and there, and we understand that. But one thing you can do, one thing that I just charge you to do is continue to look around this room and see what precious things Jesus is doing. and let's figure each other out, and let's figure what God is doing. And so I appreciate your patience while we do that. Anybody else? Questions or comments? Dave, you got the mic? Okay, thank you. Oh, right over here, please. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Are you actually 6'1" and 96 pounds?
I was maybe a little heavier than that. I went up before I went out. I was a tall, gangly person. Actually, that gentleman standing beside you, if you could have seen him when he was 17, he looked like a Q-tip. He was all ears and feet, and everything else was just ramrod straight. You know, he was tall. And I was like that, too. I was just super skinny. I remember I went into this jean shop, and they had to dig in the back to find the jeans. I had a 30 waist and a 36 length. You know, that's pretty extreme, right? You know, like I just lost 30 pounds and I'm a 38. So you imagine. So I wasn't maybe 96, maybe I was 120, 140, but I was not much. Yeah, yeah. Why did I do that? Like how? Oh, when? Just last couple of months. My wife and I went on a diet. We call it a post-COVID recovery. A lot of us put COVID pounds on, didn't we? You know, we kind of chunked up. So I'm chunking down because I found like when you go from the bottom of the stairs to the top and you're wheezing and you're only 56, that's a problem. You know, so yeah, I'm all spry and young again and full of energy and mischief. Someone else, good question. Thank you. It's nice now that I have Tyler here because the real hard ones I can send his way. Sorry, buddy. I'm embarrassing you. First week here. I don't even know if you're coming back next week. All right. Why don't you stand? We're going to enter in worship. And the basket people are going to come collect anything you've given or filled out. And then we'll close.
Greatest love that anyone could ever know. It overcame the cross and grave to find my soul. And still I see you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home. I trust in you. With all I am, I live to see your kingdom come. And in my heart, I pray you let your will be done. Until I see you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home. I'll trust in you. And I will live to love you, and I will live to bring you praise. I will live a child in love you.
You are the voice.
You are the voice to call the universe to be. You are the whisper in my heart that speaks to me. Until I see you face to face, and grace amazing takes me home. I'll trust in you. And I will live to love you. And I will live to bring you praise, I will lift a child in all you.
I will lift,
and I will lift to love you, and I will.
A reminder, we have some of these jars in the back. We got a couple of them left. If you want to fill them, put a check or change or whatever for the Crisis Pregnancy Center, or they're called something different now, aren't they? Anyways, they help young moms who are expecting in our city, and they just want a wonderful ministry in that. And if you want to take it and fill it with change or whatever, we already have them coming back. I think there's 4 jars left, so if you want to take one home and do that. And by the way, the story with Dave and Tammy Scott, I've asked his permission to share that in churches, and he gave me his blessing to do so. I won't pull that on you, okay? If there's something going on with you, I'm not unnecessarily embarrassing anybody. But God bless you. Go with Jesus. Take up your cross. You'll be amazed where you go. All right, we'll see you next week. Thank you.